Ask you for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks to our witnesses. I want to start by reinforcing the point that Chairman DeFazio made that that demand would follow supply for efficient high-speed rail. I represent and our chairman represents a state, New Jersey, where people crowd onto trains every day, at least they did before the pandemic, even though those trains take about as long to get them from New Jersey to New York City as they did 100 years ago, when part of the trip involved getting on a passenger ferry to cross the Hudson River. That's how little progress we've made, and yet we still had standing room only until recently. If we had better, faster train service, absolutely the demand would follow, and I think that's true in many parts of the country. So to understand the problem, as you said, Mr. Porcari, we have to follow the money. We heard that since 1949, the federal investment in our highway system has been around $2 trillion. So we didn't let our highway system live or die on the free market, did we? To borrow a phrase from Judge Duhon.
No, Congressman, we did not. What we actually provided in that example is consistent multi-year funding with essentially a guaranteed cost to complete the interstate system.
Right. And had we not done that, I would imagine that the United States would look a heck of a lot different than it does today. In fact, we probably have radically different population totals in states that overwhelmingly rely on the highway system. Meanwhile, federal investment in rail has been around $96 billion, just 96 since then. Compare that to China, where in just the last 14 years, you've had about $1 trillion of government investment in building up a high-speed rail network. The United Kingdom, my understanding is that they're investing about $120 billion just now in expanding their existing network. So just now, a current investment in the UK that is greater than the sum total of all of our investments since 1949. Let's talk a little bit about the brass tacks of how this works on the Northeast Corridor, which of course you know very well. We have Acela trains, of course, that theoretically can run up to 150 miles an hour. In reality, that would be still pathetic compared to France and Germany and China, but in reality, we don't come close to that. So my question for you is, as a practical matter, why can't we have nice things? What are the physical, practical impediments to achieving higher speeds? Is it the tracks? Is it the catenary? Is it something else? What are the political and regulatory obstacles? And are these obstacles surmountable in your view?
Congressman, we certainly have technical obstacles. You mentioned catenary, the right-of-way itself, the alignment of it. None of those are insurmountable. We have a 111-year-old tunnel in New York. We have a BNP tunnel in Baltimore that's Civil War era. Those are not the biggest obstacles. It is more a question of will. What we want to do as a country in infrastructure, we do. And we've never made rail really the priority that I think it needs to be. And we've never provided meaningful choices for the states to select rail and build a multi-year rail program because we don't have the funding part of it. There are other regulatory and other issues, but I would say that the passenger rail system in the US is moving from a survival mode to a growth mode. And I think that's a very healthy thing for the country, whether you're talking about our cross-country service, one of the coastal corridors, or the Midwest service. All of that is really important. And just the same way we built the interstates, city pairs aggregating into a national system, we can really do that with the passenger rail system if we have the will.
Well, thank you so much. And, you know, just to close, for me, this is It's a practical question. It's a matter of competitiveness. It's about whether the United States can do and be seen to do great things again. But it's also a question of freedom. I want my constituents, I want all my colleagues' constituents to have the greater freedom to choose to live where they want to live, to be able to get to work in a variety of different ways that people all around the world have and Americans do not. And I hope that's something we can come together around on this committee. Thank you so much. I yield back.
And thank the gentleman. It's duly noted that it's not a mistake that four members of the New Jersey delegation are on transportation. We are bound by railroads in our state, coming from every direction in every community. So this is a very important topic for us. Now I recognize